Should the product owner be at the retrospective? This is something that I get asked a lot, and it's not a simple answer. But for me, this isn't about rules. So I'm not going to refer to the Scrum Guide or the Scrum Framework, Agile in general, or any kind of rule. Okay, what I'm interested in is it helpful? Is it effective? Does it help us be better? Now, in my experience, without doubt, the best retrospectives that I've seen are ones where the product owner has been present. And the worst retrospectives are ones where the product owner has been present. So to me, in my experience, in my opinion, without doubt, it has a massive impact. Now, I do get a lot of people who tell me that the developers just aren't going to be really honest if the product owner's there. Or it could turn into a, you did this and you did that kind of argument. And that's absolutely true. It can happen. I've seen it. But I've also seen that even with just developers in the room or Zoom call, that can happen. So it's not necessarily about the role being there. You could say, should Geoff be at the retrospective? And my answer would pretty much be the same. And Geoff could be a developer, it could be a product owner, it could be a coach, it could be anyone. My answer would be pretty much the same. With anybody attending a retrospective, they're only going to add value and get value, I think, if there's a psychologically safe environment where they can share, where they can learn, and where there's some kind of either explicit or implicit agreement where we're all going to participate openly and respectfully. So in an ideal world, I think I would like to be in a position where the product owner would want to be there, where other people would want them there, and where they could contribute and learn, add value, and make this retrospective better. So what can you do to increase the chances of getting yourself into that position where you could have a product owner at a retrospective and it be better than if the product owner were not there? I've got 7 things for you to do. Okay, the first one is to set expectations. Let everybody know what's to be expected of being at this retrospective. Not just the agenda and the topic and the time box and all that kind of stuff, but also how we're going to act with one another, right? So set some expectations. People are going to be there. We're going to talk openly. We're going to focus our conversation. It's going to be respectful. It's not going to be recorded and all that kind of stuff. So set some expectations and then start small would be my second tip. Start with a retrospective where, you know, it's not going to be too risky. It's not going to be too personal. It's not going to be too touchy or sensitive a topic. Just get used to having those kinds of conversations, that reflection, that learning, that sharing as a wider group. And my third tip is to practice some kind of feedback tool that helps people communicate constructively with one another. Now, I've got a video on nonviolent communication, which is an example of that, and I'll link to that in the comments. Now, that might seem a little bit formulaic or a little bit too structured or a little bit too formal, but that's because you're not used to it. The more you get used to talking that way and getting across those kinds of concepts in a similar way, the less formal and the less awkward that feels. But whatever it is, being able to get across our point of view constructively, challenge each other constructively, just practice some kind of tool for that. My fourth tip is to use the past to focus on the future. While retrospectives are deliberately defined and set up, the purpose is to look at what has happened. But the real purpose is to use that learning to focus on the future. So don't get stuck in what happened. Acknowledge what happened, capture what happened, but always bring it back to, so how can we use that? How can we make the future better because of what we're doing here? My fifth tip would be to get a facilitator. That could be your Scrum Master. It could be the Scrum Master from another team, an Agile coach, anybody who's got good skills at bringing people into conversations, facilitating the flow of those conversations, making sure that we can stick to our working agreements, that we can remain respectful. And that brings me on to my sixth tip, which is actually to get some working agreements in place. So how you're going to speak to one another, how you're going to act, how you're going to manage differences of opinions, how you're going to make decisions, get those working agreements in place. So as an example, encourage the use of we instead of you, or no finger pointing, right? Assuming good intent. The prime directive of the retrospectives is a good place to start there. And my seventh tip is to inspect and adapt. So you start small, you learn, you do a retrospective on that retrospective perhaps, find out what worked, what didn't work, how you could step up the levels of safety to step up the levels of sensitivity. Inspect and adapt the feedback tools or the conversation structures that you're using, the working agreements that you're using, the facilitator that you're using. Always look at how you can make it better. So overall, I think if you can get a product owner into your retrospectives are going to be richer. You're going to be looking at problems as a team. You're going to be looking at solutions as a team, continuous improvement as a team, rather than us and them. But it needs to be a gradual process. Okay, it needs to be a willing process. We need to be open to this and work towards it, perhaps step by step. But give it a go, and let me know how you get on.